statement is the first thing I'm going
to
say.
No, aren't you glad you don't have to deal with Wallach and me and Cohen anymore?
Okay,
I felt like we were here once a month.
Pretty much my statement of everything that took place, right?
When you file your notice of appeal, you also file with it.
All right, Mr. Doyle says he's not opposing the adjournment, the 30-day adjournment.
Yeah, real quick.
From what I remember, it was like an affidavit of everything that took place.
One 30-day adjournment. That's all you could consent to anyway.
Right. But I'm consenting to do it again, just saying it's fine.
So any further requests you would oppose?
Something like that.
Right. But even if you didn't oppose, you'd have to come to us to get permission.
I don't remember that.
Oh, okay. Go ahead. I stopped you in mid-sentence.
Oh, I don't even remember where I was. The fundamental issue here is that the disciplinary committee had an opportunity to bring charges. They served me with a letter well before this custody decision came out. Mr. Doyle deposed me. He sent me multiple letters. They had a chance to bring charges. And the deposition revealed that Mr. Doyle somehow knew what the findings were going to be 2 weeks before the decision came out, the custody decision. The findings in the custody decision. He was asking me questions which were very pointed that Ms. Comfort and I had no idea that Judge Cooper was going to make findings about. But they waited until this custody decision came out and proceeded to file a collateral estoppel disciplinary proceeding solely based on Justice Cooper's custody decision. That custody decision, as you know, has been here, had adjournment, but now it's finally on the calendar. It would be very prejudicial to discipline me in a collateral estoppel proceeding before this court can reach the merits of the appeal. I mean, I think in the motion I've raised a lot of issues. They've complained about my conduct on the record, but you had Justice Cooper on the record calling me a mama's boy, making fun of me for not being potty trained, challenging me to a fist fight, wanting to go outside and rumble. You had, like I said, with the expert, he said that I wrote the expert's report and therefore I spoon-fed him his conclusions. Well, that's not true. Dr. Mannion actually testified that he wrote his report. And the disciplinary committee was fully aware that Justice Cooper mischaracterized his testimony, and yet they used it to charge me with putting up false testimony, expert testimony. They've even, another example, Justice Cooper precluded me from introducing electronic evidence that these FaceTime recordings were spliced. And he precluded me from calling a witness who was available to testify, just precluded her from testifying, who were on these calls, who were saying, oh yeah, the Comforts were goading him. And there was call logs that showed that there was time. He precluded all that evidence, admitted the recordings in without an authenticating witness. And now the disciplinary committee is coming after me because I called my father-in-law a bad name. Like, out of all the things in the world, the disciplinary committee is trying to charge me with misconduct for calling my father-in-law a bad name in a private telephone call, which we can't even get the full picture of. But the key here is that there are substantial issues on appeal that this decision is going to get overturned. Disciplining now will only prejudice me, only stigmatize me. You can't take it back once it's out there. Even if the custody decision is vacated, there is now a record that there was a disciplinary proceeding against me. It's going to, if the disciplinary proceeding or if the disciplinary decision comes out first, which if it stays brief now, it most likely will.
I don't know how long it's going to take.
But there's substantial case law that in these types of situations, the best practice is to hold to stay the matter pending the outcome of the appeal, particularly where there's meritorious arguments on appeal.
Well, stay releases on the decision, perhaps. What do you have to say?
Well, really what I have to say, I'm going to repeat, this is the fifth time that this argument has been made, that the collateral estoppel should not appeal. It was made to the court by his counsel. It was made to this court by him in a separate affidavit. It was made to referee Gold, Martin Gold. It was made to Clerk Rojas when the question of the timing of the referee's report came. But that's really not the most important thing. His whole argument is premised on the reliability and fairness of Justice Cooper. So really the most illuminating thing I can give you is this order of protection, which was issued yesterday, that he had to accede to. Saying he's no longer allowed to go near Justice Cooper. Now, I'm happy to give you the history of why the criminal charges that he was facing, that he had to plead down to disorderly conduct and ascend to this protective order. And by the way, the disorderly conduct will never be sealed. That's extraordinary. You might have some experience in the criminal courts. That's quite extraordinary. So this really says
this is relevant.
May I finish? This says it all. He can talk about Justice Cooper from now until the cows come home, right? The record is clean. Justice Cooper gave a very fair trial. He had counsel when he wanted counsel. His notion that I ran off his counsel, either Sarah Jo Hamilton or Mr. Supple, neither of them are going to be run off, and in any event, there was never any abuse or threats. Those are just, I'm going to have to use just a very direct word, those are just lies. And this application is frivolous, it's a waste of time, and finally, it is prejudicial that Mr. Zappa continues, despite his publicized antics, that he can be considered a member of good standing of the New York Bar. The disciplinary rules provide for us to protect the public and for us to protect the integrity and honor of the profession. That's the phrase in the rules, right? His remaining a member of the bar is in and of itself prejudicial. But again, as to the reliability of everything he's saying, this says it all.
Here, can I respond? Can I have a copy of that, please?
You don't have a copy?
No, I'd like your copy, actually.
Yeah, I'm sure you'd like a lot of things.
So, this resulted from an incident. So let me say this. This resulted not from anything that happened in court, as Mr. Doyle knows. This happened when Justice Cooper was walking out of the disciplinary committee's building when I was walking to class, and he spat on me. And then, yes. And then the district attorney's office and Justice Cooper said, oh, we have a videotape that disproves Mr. Zappin's allegation. And 6 months later, they turn it over, and you know what it shows? Nothing.
Who said there was a videotape?
Justice Cooper and the district attorney's office.
Said there was a videotape of him spitting on you?
Said that there was a videotape where we passed each other on the street and nothing happened. The videotape is up on YouTube. You can look at it. Doesn't show. In fact, it corroborates. But regardless.
At this point, he raised a procedural point.
You can put anything on
right.
Is there a means by which this can be recorded?
You don't have
because these are outright lies that he's telling, and he will be held accountable to them when he seeks reinstatement.
Let me just say one thing. This has nothing to do with the proceeding, with the custody proceeding. Justice Cooper recused himself, making up patently false lies the day before he pressed charges against him, saying that I contacted his son, saying that I had published defamatory websites about him, saying that none of it. It was just totally unsubstantiated. And then I got thrown into Rikers for 4 days, and no one could post bail. Not my attorneys, not my parents, not my friends, not my girlfriend. No one could post bail because they didn't know where I was. So this is a whole separate issue. With regard to the disciplinary issue, if Mr. Doyle thought that I was such a danger to the public, he has the power to file for a motion to temporarily suspend me. It's been 2 years that this has pending. He has not.
No? Actually, there's an interim suspension. Yes, there is that. That has very limited grounds. I didn't. Since Mr. Zappin dissembles as easily as he breathes, we didn't have any admissions. We didn't have incontrovertible evidence. And the most efficient way to proceed was once those were requirements under the rule we're talking about. Once we had the decision on which we could officially move for collateral estoppel, we did so. We was heard with his argument about appeal, and that was rejected, as it should be rejected today. He's also leaving out the fact that the district attorney's office charged him with a misdemeanor. That's why he pled to disorderly conduct that will never be seen, which again is quite extraordinary. This idea that this does not represent just further craziness on Mr. Zappin's part toward Justice Cooper and the world, including me, who is threatening to sue in federal court. Well,
we will be in federal court.
That's
listen, we're going to federal court. I mean, that's the thing. And if you want to be the man who is known for unraveling collateral estoppel in New York, it's going to be glorious.
I'm going to be happy to be the first one.
I'm going to love it.
For having you disbarred until you're fit to be an attorney. And I hope that day comes, and I mean that sincerely.
Please do not direct any further comments to me.
No, please. Please act like a lawyer.
Okay. Thank you so much, officer.
What do you say?
Have a good day,
all
right?
Please.